So first of all, let me say how honored I am to be here tonight. And when I heard the name with the word Asilomar, when I saw that in the email, I literally gasped, because this is one of the most historic meeting sites in the history of modern biology. So let me begin by pointing out that next month, on February the 12th, we will celebrate the 50th anniversary of what was the first International Union of Biological Sciences symposium held here on general biology. And what came out of that was this marvelous collection, The Genetics of Colonizing Species, edited by Herbert Baker and George Ledyard Stebbins. It was organized under the aegis of this man, who everybody is reading. I can't keep his book on my shelf. It keeps getting recalled by my colleagues in various biology units, Conrad Hal Waddington. And here are photographs of who was at Berkeley. Ledyard Stebbins had been at Berkeley and then moved to the University of California, Davis. So we commemorate and we honor their work when we meet at Asilomar this year. Let me start this presentation, and I warn you, it'll be unusual. It's one of the few talks at ASN with no curves, no numbers, no organisms, but you will get a lot of people and a lot of texts. I warn you in advance. Let me start with these two marvelous epigraphs that frame my talk this evening. The American Naturalist has had a long, distinguished career, and its various changes have mirrored changes in biological thought. Edgar Anderson from 1951. And then we have Elsie Dunn in 1966. The Naturalist reflected the changes in emphasis which were occurring in biology. Yet another epigraph from Elsie Dunn again. It is probably true that the Naturalist is the oldest continuously published American biological journal. Quite true. Propositions. We might call them arguments, or I might call them theories of my own that follow from their insights and also from mine. The history of the American Naturalist and the American Society of Naturalists is the history of American biology, and you can ask me all about what I mean by American biology perhaps afterwards or in subsequent conversations. The Society has suffered or perhaps grown. I'm not sure that it's necessarily suffered, but you'll see it did cause quite a bit of stress in the leadership of the organization. It goes through periodic identity crises that follow the trajectory of major developments in biological science. The periodic crises lead to moments of transition, which is why I've retitled my talk around the theme of moments of transition. It's not incessant. There's periodic happenings that we see when we look at the last approximately 100 years. I've chosen to stop in 1977, from 1867 to 1977. The late 19th century sees a transition from the phrase naturalist to biologist. And let us recall, Darwin was not a biologist. He was a naturalist. I don't know anyone who will call him correctly or accurately a biologist, even an evolutionary biologist. The phrase evolutionary biology is really gains acceptance in the 1940s. He's a naturalist. What do we mean by naturalist? What is natural history? What is natural philosophy? And here I draw on my colleague, and some of you know him, Robert P. McIntosh, who wrote a marvelous life history of the American Midland Naturalist in 1990, and on page 13, he provides us with a really very nice definition, if you will. Nature, naturalist, natural philosophy, and natural history have long circuitous histories and connotations extending to Aristotle and likely beyond. Natural history developed in the recognition and description of objects and phenomena in the material world, sometimes even unreal objects and phenomena such as unicorns, griffins, and plants producing animal offsprings were incorporated in early volumes of natural history. So that can be our starting point. What do we mean by naturalist? What is natural history? The journal American Naturalist is established in the year 1867, and I met at least one Canadian in the room. This is an important date, and it's not insignificant. What happens in 1867 in Canada?
Confederation.
Confederation, that is correct. And that is because we're told a bunch of, really, what happens is a bunch of businessmen are afraid of the northern armies that are lying dormant, and they're afraid of invasion by the Americans. And this is a long way of telling you that it's in the context of an extremely turbulent period that we see the developments that begin to create what becomes the American Naturalist and the American Society of Naturalists, which is kind of afterwards. Usually you get the society forming and then the journal comes. The journal emerges. American Naturalist comes before the actual society. So the punchline is context matters, and I'll give you a little bit of a sense of what happens in that early period. The period of Reconstruction, or Reconstruction in America, sees unprecedented growth in the number of American institutions as the intellectual infrastructure of what becomes the modern American, I call it a research complex. It's not just universities, because it also includes field stations of various kinds, institutes of science, you know, things like the Wagner Free Institute of Science. A number of museums are created, and really the late 19th century sees the boom in these museums, especially of natural history. Very importantly for us, I get this question all the time from people, when do the first professorships of biology become available? And that's not until about the 1880s. And it's a place like Johns Hopkins University that has one of the first biology programs run by William Keith Brooks, the embryologist. And doctoral programs come to be important. Remember, in the late 19th century, a lot of biologists didn't actually have doctoral degrees. They didn't need them for employment. Or they may have been wealthy amateurs who were engaged in natural history. And these were very legitimate scientists without PhDs. 1862, one of the great achievements of President Lincoln was the passing of the Morrill Act that created the system of land-grant universities, the state schools that are comprehensive and integrative in nature. And I think there's an entire book to be written about the importance of the land-grant schools and the development of what becomes American biology. So we have all of these agricultural, after that we have the Hatch Act that creates agricultural experiment stations. We have other developments, and here let me just refer you to the work of some of my colleagues. Mark Barrow, who looks at the kind of cultural history of late 19th century America, and he tracks what comes to be what he calls nature's ghost, which is the growing recognition that America's wildlife is disappearing. Carolina parakeets, passenger pigeons, the American bison. It's in the late 19th century, roughly at the same time that American Naturalist is created, that Americans are coming to realize, my goodness, we have this distinct identity, and it resides in much of the wildlife. And it tracks all of this and the way that the Endangered Species Act is passed, etc. We have another work by Sally Polstead, and I don't like the title. I don't think it does the topic justice, Teaching Children Science. And what she looks at is what she calls the nature study movement. All through the 19th century, natural history and nature study were taught to women and to children. And let us recall that natural history was very closely linked to moral philosophy, natural theology. As Darwin himself had studied natural theology, that was one of his passions and interests. But in any case, study of the natural world was a way of communing with God, with the Creator, and it blends, it kind of evolves into what becomes science education. She ends this book, actually, with Rachel Carson. We have other books, like this one, that goes into the period of museum building. And many of you may know about the famous Bone Wars, Othniel Marsh versus Edward Drinker Cope. Literally, quite literally, it was like spy versus spy, engaging in these celebrated internecine conflicts where they were spying on each other's fossil digging sites and destroying fossil sites. It's extraordinary what they did. That was part one. Part two is explained here in the second Jurassic dinosaur rush, and this is Paul Brinkman 1890s that sees this expansionist period in museum building. Why do dinosaurs become such glamour objects? He really examines the way that the displays were set up, but also just the institutional backdrop of, of paleontology. All of this goes into creating, and this book takes us into the 20th century, the view that biology had become assimilated in American culture, and that it offered hope, salvation, that it would cure all kinds of social ills, medical ills, and so on. In this book, the work of the late Philip Pauli. The transition into the middle decades of the 20th century is, you can find in this book, The Man Who Saved Sea Turtles by Frederick Roe Davis. He builds on the work of Paul Farber, who articulated, first used the phrase, the naturalist tradition, tracing out how, in fact, it was preserved. We have the sense that natural history died. And what this book, along with other colleagues, are now doing is the fact that natural history, no, it doesn't die. It is, in fact, continuously preserved well into the 20th century. So this is kind of the backdrop for the 19th century. And we know a lot about the late 19th century because we've been mining it for so long. And you'll see how little we know about the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s as this talk continues. But back to our founder, the founders of the American Naturalists. Okay, who are they? We've got Alpheus Packard, who is a an invertebrate biologist, worked on horseshoe crabs. We have Edward R. Morse, who was a malacologist, trained in zoology, but he also turned to Japanese culture and Japanese studies, becoming the curator of one of the great Asian art collections. We have Frederick W. Putnam, who is an anthropologist, one of the pioneers in American archaeology and anthropology, and Alpheus Hayek, who some of you may know. He's probably one of the most famous ones of this group, who is a paleontologist. What do these people all have in common? Okay, so they've got animals in common, whether they're humans or horseshoe crabs. Well, they all belong to what is called the Society for the Protection of American Students from Former Professors. And that is because they were all the pupils of this man. Louis Agassiz. And the fact of the matter is that they staged a kind of intellectual student revolt. They were dissidents. They were angry with him. They were frustrated by the fact that it appears, according to Edward Lurie, who is one of Agassiz's biographers, he refused to recommend tenure appointments for them. So they staged a kind of revolt. They all ended up getting employed in Salem, Massachusetts, and they in turn decided to create this journal, founded in 1867, and this is the frontispiece that you saw Judy had it on. Her opening slide, The American Naturalist. And let me offer a close reading. This is what historians do. We read texts very closely. A popular, illustrated magazine of natural history. Popular and illustrated. And it said inside that the intention within the actual first volume, the intention as they write it out as philosophers in seeking truth, for truth's sake, let us not forget that our science will be enabled by publishing these facts and principles which interest alike the philosopher and day laborer. Day laborer being a person who was disengaged from scientific practice. The journal, magazine, Popular Illustrated was serious. I cannot emphasize that. This is a serious journal of science, but it was also aimed at a broad spectrum of readership. And it reported on expeditions, on all kinds of curiosities, a kind of a news magazine of science at the time. And if you've never seen some of these early volumes, let me take the opportunity just to showcase both the artistry and the science just by looking at the bindings of the first four volumes. This is volume two. Volume 1. Can you see it in the back very well?
Yeah.
Okay. They're absolutely spectacular. And these are actually on open shelves at the University of Florida. I'm sure you could get them as well. Volume 4, which has, it's actually brown. I'm not sure why they changed from green to brown. And the contents had a number of illustrations that were equally both beautiful and silly and unexpected. And here we have Edward Drinker Cope, Fossil Reptiles of New Jersey. You know, I couldn't help thinking I was preparing this, and I went, no, actually, they're politicians. Speaks with forked tongues. I couldn't help it. I couldn't help it as I looked at this image. But one sees these kinds of representations in natural history, books, illustrations, and they tell us a great deal. I mean, that the word dinosaur was invented in the 1850s, and the representations of what were also called megatheria, the big beast, make us laugh right now. Some of the illustrations speak to the interest in anthropology and archaeology, and here we have primeval monuments of Peru, for example, and then we have these incredibly inventive papers, the songs of the grasshoppers. Someone studying the musical pattern trying to write out the music of grasshoppers. So this is the American Naturalist. 1871, the first of the transitions, what I call these moments of transitions, and this one is fairly painless. And we have an illustrated magazine of natural history. The first transition signals professionalization. And that's because the term popular is removed. It's not that it no longer is supposed to engage a public audience, the so-called day laborer. It's not that it's not meant to, but it's that it is diminished. And we know this because by the late 19th century, we see a widening chasm between professional scientists and amateurs. You see it in ornithology, you see it in botany, you see it in all kinds of locations. And incidentally, that's also a historical moment when a number of women who were classed as amateurs, even though they actually knew a great deal about science, were actually sidelined even more so. So 1871, the first of the transition. It accompanies professionalization, as I said, but with it, professionalization, there also came specialization. And in 1883, finally, when the ASN is actually founded, it was the only organization, interestingly enough, that did not have a disciplinary project. It was not defined by any kind of disciplinary focus. It did emphasize professionalization, however, and according to Charles Sedgwick Minot, one of the early founding fathers, quotation mark around that, who was actually one of the early secretaries, I believe, the second one, the ASN was the first society to restrict membership to professionals through its constitution. And that's one of the demarcations, one of the distinctions of the ASN. The membership clause of the constitution read as follows: membership in this society shall be limited to instructors in natural history, officers of museums, and other scientific institutions, physicians, and other persons professionally engaged in some branch of natural history. And let us recall that a number of physicians were also skilled naturalists. A number of people were actually doctors, but they were also naturalists. And, as well, physiologists and anatomists were also part of the original ASN. The emphasis of the meetings at ASN was focused at this interval of time on techniques and research as well as education. And despite the fact that the pupils of Louis Agassiz were in revolt against him, they nonetheless embody his vision of science in the late 19th century. He really focused education and outreach in his own work. He was the creator of what became the first major museum of natural history, the Museum of Comparative Zoology. And one of his pupils that I've got to single out, because he's got a great haircut, but also because I think it's just a marvelous portrait, Edward Drinker Cope. And he's one of the two involved in the Bone Wars of the late 19th century. He was the owner and then became the co-editor of the American Naturalist. not common today and you may not be aware of is the fact that journals in the late 19th century and even into the beginnings of the 20th century were privately owned. You didn't necessarily subscribe to a society and in that process subsidize the journal. That's not the way it happened. The journal was supposed to be money-making. It was, that's what we mean by privately owned. And his estate purchased it, and he began to be one of the co-editors of the estate. And I just finished researching the history of the American Journal of Botany. That was one of the few journals that was actually independently funded by the actual membership of the BSA. The Brooklyn Botanic Garden also provided some of the costs, but that's because the early members of the BSA were exceedingly wealthy, kind of elites in the Northeast. But in any case, it was very rare to have a journal that was actually funded by the membership. That's really an important part of that early history. Toby Appel, in 1989, described the early ASN as, quote, a halfway house. That is, by its existence, encouraged the formation of disciplinary societies and enabled them to survive their early years. I prefer to modernize the term. It's a little bit unflattering to think of the ASN as a halfway house. So let's conceive of it as a kind of innovation incubator or a hub for spawning other societies. And that's not too different from Brother C. Edward Quinn, who wrote a history of the American Society of Zoologists, and he wrote the following. The point we should notice, however, is how prolific an ancestor ASN proved to be. While changing little itself, it contained numerous homunculi. These are these little people, perfectly formed little people that were present in the 17th century drawings that were the emboîtement, if you know anything about embryology. That's how he chose to think of it. These homunculi, each ready to emerge and mature when its time had come. Look at all these homunculi. The American Association of Anatomists, the American Physiological Society, the American Morphological Society, which later on became the American Society of Zoologists, Botanical Society of America, sort of, and then finally the Geological Society, which emerged in I believe it was in the 1880s. So these were all associated, all had members, and they were all nurtured in some fashion by the early ASN membership. But once they emerged as disciplinary entities, and remember ASN was non-disciplinary, once these disciplinary societies began to emerge, they also began to cut into the membership. And what had been a healthy society, every time the ASN met, there were always, was always well attended. By the 1890s, approximately, we see a society that is losing its membership. It's so slowly beginning to kind of peter out or poop out. So in 1892, the leadership of the ASN literally reached out to the American Psychological Association, which was a fairly new society, to G. Stanley Hall, who was its president in particular, and asked them to affiliate. Well, the far bigger crisis followed in the wake of all of this disciplinary specialization, and that was precipitated by the science calling itself genetics. Remember, William Bateson is the person who coins the term genetics. He's standing in front of the Royal Horticultural Society, and this is an elite body. These are not all scientists. A lot of them are amateurs. A lot of them are women. And he first begins to coin the term genetics, and in that context, evoke the name of Gregory Mendel, or Gregor Mendel. And let us recall, the rediscovery of Mendel's work took place in 1900, when three people independently, were told, stumbled onto his original work, Hugo de Vries, Karl Korens, Eric von Chermak. This is a well-known story. But the science of genetics doesn't just slowly creep in, it quite literally explodes. It explodes in the United States especially because it was tied so closely to practical breeding, to animal breeding, to the numerous agricultural schools that were receptive, or especially receptive, to the knowledge that had come from Gregory Mendel. So this is an extraordinary period. I prefer to think of it as a kind of, it's not that the society fractionates, it's quite literally that something outside or related to it begins to emerge, exploding on the scene. And that is actually part of an intellectual ferment. And it's something exciting. It's a new science that is quite literally being born. And the second thing that happens is that many people begin to want to understand the many factors of evolution. We call this epoch, an older generation of historians of science termed this interval of time, the eclipse of Darwin. That's actually Julian Huxley's term in 1942 when he writes The Modern Synthesis. And that's not really right. It's not that the Darwinism is eclipsed. It's that there's so much going on in evolution. It's not that there aren't people interested. It's that they're looking for material causes. They're looking for the mechanisms of evolution. And in particular, they're looking for the factors of evolution. That's one of the reasons they begin to turn to mutation theory, aristogenesis, directed evolution, a number of neo-Lamarckism, as was endorsed especially by people like Cope and Hayek and Picard. The students of Agassiz tended to favor progressivist evolution moving forward. So there's intellectual reasons. Things are happening at the turn of the century. This is not a bad thing. This is typical of what happens when you have huge influx of resources, people, needs, a developing nation. Remember, the United States around the year 1900 is emerging. It's beginning to emerge as a kind of international force by the especially after the First World War, when Europe is decimated. So this is actually a good thing. The other thing that happens that is not entirely intellectual in nature is that this man begins to assume editorship and to buy the journal. And he buys it in 1907 from the estate of Cope, James McKean Cattell, who happened to be a psychologist interested in psychometrics. We're told that's his interest. He also was into doing drugs and all kinds of other things. A really interesting figure, a kind of, he really pushed the envelope. But he was especially interested in publications and in the dissemination of information. And that's one of the reasons he also begins to edit the journal Science. And all through this interval of time, we see close association between American naturalists and also of science. And he's really not the brain or, you know, behind the American naturalist as he makes that transition. The person who really embodies the vision of what would be the American naturalist during the next interval of time, this transition that I want to describe, is this man, who you likely know, Thomas Hunt Morgan, starts out in embryology. He's interested in evolution, but he's very impatient with the absence of experimental rigor. He turns to Drosophila melanogaster, and you know the rest really is history. We can see him here, a photograph in front of the bottles and the so-called fly room at Columbia. He later moves to Caltech. But it's actually Thomas Hunt Morgan who begins to embody the vision, and he's quite literally directing it. We're told that he was very close to James McKean Cattell. So he's directing the trajectory of the journal, which of course becomes very, very heavily representative of what would be the new genetics. And L.C. Dunn's 1966 paper tells us that he published over 40 papers in the American Naturalist subsequently. When you look at the American Naturalist before 1907, and you don't see very much in genetics, and you don't see very much in evolution. And it's really genetics and evolution that will become the dominant themes of the journal and also the interests of the society. But we see, before this is established, we see all through the pages of Science, and again, remember, it's also been published by James McKean Cattell, 1907 and 1908, this is just a page, just a quotation. The following circular is published in the hope of reaching many members of the affiliated societies who are not now members of the Society of Naturalists. It is hoped that all who are interested in the scientific study of evolution, and I note the term scientific study, which makes you wonder, was there a non-scientific study? What they really mean by that is the emphasis is actually very heavily experimental and laboratory based. That's really what this invitation is saying. The scientific study of evolution will join the naturalists in making a systematic effort to present the results of modern investigation in the field. Many who have not hitherto attended to the matter will also now appreciate the other advantages to be accomplished by strengthening this association of the special scientific societies to which they belong. Announcement, the reorganization, and the annual meeting. In view of the opinion so widespread that American Society of Naturalists has no important function and is not meeting the requirement of proper cooperation between its affiliated societies and others, the following plan is presented. It is suggested that the main object of the society be considered the study of evolution in all of its many-sided aspects, historical, environmental, experimental, etc. There is no subject which would so well hold together all the present members, including botanists, zoologists, physiologists, anatomists, paleontologists, anthropologists, etc. It is one of the first so-called, I call them unifying arguments. And remember, we all live under Dobzhansky's famous assertion that evolution is the central organizing principle of biology. Evolution as the unifying principle. Here, it's of all the sciences. It isn't only of biology. That's Dobzhansky's twist in the 1960s. But it happens to belong to the American Society of Naturalists first. It is argued by those who regard the Society of Naturalists as an anachronism, that natural history is no more than in the differentiation and specialization that accompany the science, it is broken up into botany, zoology, etc. What is the remedy? Seek an association of workers on general biological topics for the presentation and discussion of the results of investigations on such topics. Such an association is already organized. The American Society of Naturalists is dignified by years of service and a membership that includes the most eminent of American biologists. Except in its early years, it has been, as it now is, an exclusively biological society. That's actually a slam at Louis Agassiz and his many students, and it's one of the first times that we see the word biology directly applied to the vision of the American Society of Naturalists. Also from science, 1908, if you can believe this one, I was floored. I've written a history of the Darwin Centennial Celebration of 1959, so I was absolutely floored to find out that in the 1909 celebration, in the planning of that, the American Society of Naturalists was actually left out. And this was the AAAS that was organizing this big Darwin Memorial. So here we have complaints in 1908 from the secretary of ASN, H. McKee Nower, who writes on the Darwin Centennial Celebration, "Here arrangements, peculiarly the province of naturalists, have been perfected without consulting their official representatives." Huh. You know, he's very upset about this. And then he writes later on, just to paraphrase it, "The fault lies not with the AAAS, it lies with the naturalists because they failed to organize themselves to support evolution." In other words, this is what you get when you are part of the Agassiz group. You really don't support evolution, you don't support theory, you don't support genetics, and as a consequence, you are left out of the biggest happening at the turn of the century, namely the Darwin celebration. 1909 is, of course, the 50th anniversary of the publication of On the Origin of Species, the 100th anniversary of the birth of Charles Darwin. So as a result, we see this transitional moment, 1908, where it becomes a monthly journal devoted to the advancement of the biological sciences with special reference to the factors of evolution. This is now on the masthead of the journal. It's a major transition in that it sees an emphasis on genetics, experimentation, or laboratory science, but also theory. The emphasis is on theory at that time, and evolutionary theory in particular. Emphasis is also on the phrase biological science. Agassiz's influence is over in the year, ironically, that the American naturalist was also celebrating his birth. So it was, he was born in 1807, and the American naturalist, which is his students, actually, the achievement that his students bring forth is now in transition. Between 1907 and 1945, approximately, I think, I chose 1945 because it's the end of the Second World War, it sees the death of Thomas Hunt Morgan, and as we'll see, lots of things happen during this interval of time. A number of important works begin to be published in genetics and evolution. The next crisis, and then the transition, is actually precipitated as a result of success, too much success again, in both genetics and evolution. The unification of the two come together beautifully in the 1920s and the 1930s, the fusion of genetics and evolution, and in turn, it means an appropriation of that unifying argument. The real heavy in the story, the crisis, is this man. That's a fly out. I like that one because it's a bird. And as we know, Ernst Mayr was the great avian biologist of his time, the author of Systematics and the Origin of Species, 1942. And you know, I've gone down on the record as calling him the Darwin of the 20th century. This man is a naturalist, above all. And in his historical work, he really endorses the view that naturalist systematists are responsible for the evolutionary synthesis. He writes the whole of Systematics and the Origin of Species, incidentally, because of the successful work of this man, right? Mayr's book, Systematics and the Origin of Species, is meant to be a direct assault. It's a response. It's a salvo that he fires against Theodosius Dobzhansky. The title of his book is Genetics and the Origin of Species, 1937. And he chooses that title because he believes that Darwin has really failed to come up with a viable theory of heredity. It was one of the scientific criticisms that you could justly make. He just didn't know very enough about inheritance to be able to really justify and explain this theory fully. That's what happens between 1859 and about 1920, is that genetics needs to be worked out and then brought in together with selection theory, with Darwinian selection theory. It's not just Ernst Mayr and Theodosius Dobzhansky, it's these people as well. And I love this photograph, and now that I show it, if I travel and I'm asked to show it, I always get a question from the audience, you know, Betty, they're also male. And I go, yes, this is the society, what becomes the Society for the Study of Evolution. The celebrated Princeton meetings, the bicentennial of Princeton, saw this, you know, august body. I love this photograph. Let's show you a real rarity. R.A. Fisher next to Sewell Wright. You got the joke. I don't need to explain it. They didn't get along. Not at all. In fact, they would very often, if they were forced to sit next to each other, they would turn their backs on each other. They absolutely refused to work with each other. It was kind of embarrassing. That Sturdivant next to them. Here's Ernst Mayr, G.G. Simpson, the paleontologist, Ledyard Stebbins, J.B.S. Holliday, E.B. Ford. Dobzhansky is up there next to Edgar Anderson. And if you like, we can, you know, I have the chart that will identify the august body that convened. Muller's in there, like everybody who's anybody on the scene of, on the face of evolution, convenes, comes together at Princeton. And remember, it's the end of the war, and they're holding out. They're one of the reasons of the Society for the Study of Evolution. And here it is, the foundation document, and this is a photograph provided by, given to me by Jim Crow, and this is a photograph that comes out of the 1970 Austin meetings, but it's a photographic reproduction that was given to participants that was actually the founding document, the signatories of what became the SSC. And at the top, the handwriting at the top is Ernst Mayr's signature. It is his signature, but also it's up there. Members in attendance at St. Louis, 1946, comes out of the American Association for the Advancement of Science meetings. And let's recall, one of the reasons that the SSC was launched in the United States of America, and the journal Evolution, the international journal Evolution, was launched in the United States of America, is the fact that printing paper were incredibly expensive in the post-war period in the United Kingdom, in England at the time. So they really couldn't afford to put out the journal. Remember, there's something called the Second World War. And one of the reasons they're jubilant, they're celebrating, is the fact that they could finally get gasoline to be able to come together and to have one of these large meetings. So we're looking at a nation that is quite literally in the grip of war, but scientists are continuing to work, even though many of them have turned to war-related research. But everything just explodes on the scene in the post-war period, as, of course, the United States of America emerges. Europe is in tatters, quite literally, emerges as the powerhouse, thanks in part to a lot of immigrant scientists. Meyer is, of course, German, and he immigrates before the war, but he stays in the United States. Theodosius Dobzhansky is a Soviet exile, an immigrant. He never returns to the Soviet Union. He's banned from returning. But a lot of immigrant scientists came to the United States. A lot of the infrastructure that we now know, that we associate with modern biological science, is formed in the post-war period, including the National Science Foundation, founded approximately 1950, but in any case, that's kind of the context. 1946 in the journal Nature, and again, it's Nature, it's not science. Nature is considered more international in nature. The announcement of the new Society for the Study of Evolution is made. A Society for the Study of Evolution was formed on March 40, 1946, on the occasion of the meeting of the American Association for the Advancement of Science in St. Louis. The object of the society is the promotion of the study of organic evolution and the integration of the various fields of biology, such as taxonomy, paleontology, genetics, that are interested in evolution. The Society for the Study of Evolution was the kind of a union between the Society for the Study of Speciation, which was created in the late 1930s. These were all systematists. Biosystematists is what they termed themselves. And it joined with the Committee on Common Problems in Genetics, Paleontology, and Evolution. And most of the members of the committee happened to be paleontologists, mostly located around the American Museum of Natural History. And they all came together to create the SSE and to launch this new international journal called Evolution. The problem was that it was just too close to the American Society of Naturalists and the journal American Naturalists. Some of the enthusiastic members of the SSC proposed a takeover of the older journal, though by joint agreement. They would negotiate and they would then take over the new journal. Alfred Kinsey, and we seem to forget that the man was a gall-wasp systematist. He was a great systematist before he turned to his sex research. He was actively involved in the Society for the Study of Evolution, and he opposed the takeover of the ASN and the American Naturalist. And you know, one of the reasons he didn't like it, he didn't want to do that, is because he said, well, heck, the American Naturalist is actually owned by a bunch of people who want to make money. They're not really interested in promoting science, and that is, in fact, fairly true, especially by the late 1940s. In defense, H.G. Muller, the Drosophila geneticist, writes the following: a considerable number among the naturalists, including perhaps the majority of the executive committee, see little point in having it, meaning the relationship between the ASN and AMNAT and the SSC, continue as a rival society, and would, if there were a dignified way out, favor giving over the advantages of their old standing and prestige to the new society. As you know, they have been in the past, whether or not officially, the only society whose main interest was in evolution. And I do not think they can be changed in that respect. Continues, should the attitude of the new society be one of artificial aloofness, as though naturalists did not exist, despite the greatly overlapping membership, etc., allowing the naturalists to gradually wither away? Or should they, if they are willing, be accepted into some kind of association or merger? Meyer responds, and he is ferocious. He is This is one of the ways that I think he really contributes to 20th century evolutionary biology. His response to Miller defended the SSE and his own sensitivity. He also flat out rejected the Cattell's offer, and the Cattell's now have shifted. It's no longer J. McKean Cattell. It's actually the son, Jacques, who then turns over the journal to his brother, Ware Cattell. But both of them are owning the journal and responsible, publishing the journal. He also flat out rejected, because Jacques Cattell tried to sell it to the SSE and to Meyer for $4,000. And Meyer thought the purchase of the journal, especially at this price, that was a lot of money in those days, merely to keep the undesirable, these are quotations taken right out of documents, name of American naturalist imprudent. Ware Cattell responded. He took over the journal as the owner and the acting editor, and his response was that the American naturalist was losing money. With the new competitor, the journal Evolution, the American naturalist was in trouble. What he did was to expand the scope of the journal to make it a news source. So this is the response that the ASN, that the American Naturalist rather had. So in 1946, in response to the new society that was forming, we find a change in editorial policy. And this quotation is taken right out of volume 80 of American Naturalist. There is a great need of integration in biological fields. This will be aided by increasing mutual understanding through the presentation of the progress of new developments, including those of special interest to the biologist in political and international matters. The American Naturalist will have served its purpose well by rallying the forces representing biologists of the country and by serving as the mouthpiece that can be quoted by newspapers at large. And there's about 10 pages of letters that are written in response that are mostly supportive of the new mission of the American Naturalist. 1948, the masthead is changed to a bi-monthly journal devoted to the advancement of the biological sciences. Okay, so it changes completely, and you can just feel the new editor, the new vision, that is all in response to the journal Evolution, but also the takeover of Ware Cattell. 1953, however, we find a return to something recognizably American Naturalist. The American Naturalist, established 1867, devoted to advancement and correlation of the biological sciences. And then underneath it said, edited in the interest of the American Society of Naturalists. And that's when a lot of my documentation stops, because in fact, most of the editors have not yet deposited their documents. I don't actually know what happens, but I can offer some suggestions by looking at the editorial board, and that is that ecologists begin to emerge. We begin to see the influence of people like G.E. Hutchinson, and in the 1960s, the merging of evolution and ecology. It actually happens in the 1930s, if you know of the work of David Lack, Ecology, Evolution, and Behavior, what I call the Holy Trinity of Evolution, begin to come together in the 1930s. But they really emerge in the 1960s, when departments of ecology and evolutionary biology begin to be created, departments of organismic biology come to be created, or departments of ecology, evolution, and behavior. It is ecology that emerges, because that's who I see on the editorial board, and that's who's publishing in the American Naturalist in the late 1950s, 1960s. By 1964, volume 98 to 99, we have devoted to the advancement and correlation of the biological sciences. And I'm not sure, maybe you can help me after, try to figure out what does correlation mean. I mean, what does to correlate the biological sciences mean? I can understand integrate. I'm not sure what they're meaning by correlation, unless there's too many mathematicians and they're using this term in some novel way. I'm not sure. I'm really not sure. The masthead underneath reads, American Naturalist is a bi-monthly journal devoted to furthering the objectives of the ASN, which are, quote, the discussion, advancement, and diffusion of knowledge concerning the broader biological problems, including organic evolution, thus serving to correlate the various biological sciences into a common philosophy of biology. It will publish those general addresses, essays, and papers presented at symposia of biological societies which contribute to the above purpose. Research papers and reviews in which theoretical interpretation and synthesis are predominant, and brief discussion, criticism, and comment on material is published in this journal and elsewhere. And finally, kind of wrapping it up, we have 1977, where we see the modern, and it's still with us today, the American naturalist devoted to the conceptual unification of the biological sciences. It remains to the present, 100 years after its founding. And let us stop there and remember how the journal began as a magazine, popular illustrations dedicated to natural history and observation and description. And as you know, if you pick up the American Naturalist starting around 1970, even 1960s, that's when the numbers, the curves, the graphs, the equations begin to appear. So thank you very much. I'll take questions afterward, and just my acknowledgement. And I really owe a great deal to my colleagues who worked the 19th century. I'm very much a 20th century being. I do go back to the 19th century, but these are the various people who have contributed to our understanding of the context in which the American Naturalist is founded, is established as a journal, and the American Society of Naturalists is created. So thank you very much. I'll take questions. I really don't know it. I mean, I'm sure you all have great stories you'd like to share about what happens in the 1960s and the 1970s, since you're the actors. And maybe I'm being a coward, because one of the rules of thumb of being a historian is you try not to give talks when the historical actors are actually alive and in the audience. I once did that at the biosystematist meeting. I spoke on Ledyard Stebbins, and Ledyard Stebbins was in the room. And somebody came up to me afterwards and said, "You interrupted the speaker too much," because he kept interrupting me every time I'd say something. "You forgot this, and this, and so on." But in any case, it is a good rule of thumb. But honestly, I really can't say with any certainty exactly what's happening, because I don't have the documents. This is a long way of asking all of you to consider donating your papers to the American Philosophical Society, because we need them. I know these people because their documents, their papers, their correspondence exists. If we lose that, and we probably will, thanks to electronic communication, we're sunk. Question?
So at the beginning, you suggested that the history of ASN and that's the history of American biology. Given the explosion of molecular biology in particular, but also things like neuroscience and so on, I mean, numerically now, whole world of biology is tiny compared to molecular biology in its various forms. So to what point do you actually think that initial statement is true? What date did the ASN perhaps stop being a history of American biology? Presumably by the Second World War, molecular biology was far more important than whole world biology.
Molecular biology is actually very recent, much more recent. 1953 is, of course, the articulation of the structure of the DNA. It's not until the 1960s. And of course, you can read it. You can read all about it in E.O. Wilson's Naturalist. He talks about the molecular wars at Harvard, and that's one of the things that gives rise to the fissure between the departments, Department of Cell and Molecular Biology, and then we have organismic biology. And so who you ask, may I provoke you? I do, I mean, may I provoke you? I have colleagues who don't think molecular biology is biology. Think about that. You know this. You know that there are a number of people. Of course, it's changed now with genomics and with the technology that's available. That whole fissure that opened up in the 1960s and the 1970s it has closed. We don't see those kinds of conflicts and struggles and so on. But, you know, I really wish to push that discussion. I'd love to have a discussion about that. Because what is molecular biology? I have colleagues in the philosophy of biology who have asked that question. What is molecular biology? They study the history of molecular biology, and they all come up with one thing. They can't find a history. They can't do something like what I've done here. What it is it's a technique, or it's driven by various kinds of techniques. So the answer to your question is you know, you'll actually, if you look hard enough, you will see molecular biology, but it's actually a reaction. It's something that's a reaction against in the 1960s, and then it's slowly assimilated. I don't know if I can get away with saying American biology by the 1970s. It seems to me, please disagree, it seems to me that the American naturalist takes advantage of a niche market, and that is stressing, again, the conceptual unification. Conceptual unification can be interpreted in a number of different ways. To me, it sounds a lot like theory, concept, unification. That those are philosophical terms that imply some kind of overarching or undergirding theory, very often mathematical in nature. So I do, I mean, if you look at the history of biology, and the other question you should ask is, you know, what do I mean by American? Do I really want to put a national label on this? And the answer is, I would put a little bit more nuance to it to say it's what happens to the history of biology in America. But it so happens that in the 20th century, especially after the First World War and the Second World War, most of the biology that is taking place, most of the developments are, maybe they may be European immigrants, but it's the United States. It shifts in the very end of the 20th century. We have a number of, you know, institutions that recover from the war. But you don't have, I just don't think you have anything comparable to the American land-grant school. I really wish somebody would really look at the contributions of the land-grant system. Places like, for example, Wisconsin, Cornell, Berkeley, and I have worked at Berkeley, looking at the creation of the Department of Genetics there. You just didn't have anything comparable in England or in Germany. They had other influences. You know, Germany has all these great museums and centers, and I don't want to but the Germans dominate the biological sciences in the 19th century. They are the great laboratory experimentalists, and to some extent, their work is imported, and their research style is imported to the U.S. But, you know, there is a kind of a flavor, a style. Some people call them epistemic styles. My colleague Jane Meinstein at Arizona State University argues for epistemic styles. She looks at the transition from German biology to American biology. But I'm not sure if that, I mean, I think your point is very well taken. I think that there is this tension in the 1960s and the 1970s between biologists and people who will be in organismic biology units and molecular and cell biologists who divide. But I'm a snob. I live in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, and one of the reasons that I love the University of Florida is the College of Ag and Life Sciences, the medical school, our Museum of Natural History, all of these marvelous units that are associated with being, you know, having a medical school on the campus, having the agricultural school on this campus, and having us in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences. I love it and I hate it because it means there's constant negotiation that has to take place. Constant. If you want to create a major, you've got to be watching what these other groups do. I have colleagues who don't think people in the medical school do biology. It's nonsense. I think it's nonsense. But you've probably all heard versions of these kinds of prejudices.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious, you said in the 1950s the ecologists started to move in to AMNAC. Have you studied anything about the history of the Ecological Society of America? Was there something happening in the ecological
Sarah
society people were running from?
I haven't. Sarah Jossen has. No, I don't think they're running from the ESA. I think what you're looking at is the wedding between ecology and evolution, and the enormously productive marriage. People call it the wedding between the two. that comes out after the 1960s. And I'm sure many of you have come out of those programs. I came out of one of them myself. But I think that's what happens. It's interesting because at Cornell, there was a graduate field called Ecology and Evolutionary Biology, but the department was actually called Ecology and Systematics. And there was this huge struggle while I was a graduate student because the systematists wouldn't give up the term systematics. And they held on to that. So there was a rift between the section and the graduate field, which was Ecology and Evolutionary Biology. I tried to look at when do the first departments of evolutionary biology come to be created. They're not. They're always in conjunction with E. It's ENEB or ENBB, Ecology, Evolution, and Behavior. That's the configuration in the 1960s, approximately. And the first, you know, Harvard is one of the first places that really sees this fissure between molecular biology and organismic biology widen. And there's a whole, you can just read the account that, the eyewitness account that E.O. Wilson has. It's actually pretty accurate. It's fun as heck. You know, when he describes James Watson as the Caligula of biology, gives you a sense of, you know, what's happening at home. And I have interviewed a number of people. Interestingly, coming back to Asilomar and California, Ledger Stebbins doesn't experience this rupture. And, you know, the people who really, really fight molecular biology are named Ernst Mayr and George Gaylord Simpson. There are a lot of museum people, naturalists in museum settings. They like genetics. They appreciate what genetics has to offer, but they're busy kind of defending and keeping a space for themselves. Ledger Stebbins is actually the chair of the genetics department at UC Davis. That's why he moves from Berkeley. And Stebbins has a very different trajectory. You know, the architects of the synthesis, who are all members of ASN and SSC, all have very different career trajectories and philosophies. So we can, no more questions. Oh, yes.
I think maybe we're kind of running on to the end of the script of time for this. I just wanted to suggest that we break for now. People, they will be around. Maybe we can have questions and corner her. But I think maybe letting people stand up for a bit. We've been sitting for an hour, and there was supposed to be a lot of stuff. So. Maybe we'll have one more question, and then we'll
break. So plants and animal ecology seem to have different journals, different chapters. And I just was curious what role the naturalists played in that.
I can't answer that. I really can't. I'm biased again. This is my personal view. I was trained in science, so I've got this kind of bias. When I look at the history of plant ecology, I see Everest with whales, I see Harper, I see a lot of the United Kingdom. I see a lot of them playing very prominent roles, but that's my training and background. I don't necessarily see that, but that's not true. We've got people like David Black and that whole Oxford school in Britain. But I can't tell you that level of specificity what happens between two.
I guess I was just thinking about, I don't remember a lot of my classic papers in plant ecology that were naturalists, but you think they're probably more animals. I suspect there were more animals than animals.
Well, I think that maybe part of that may be the, you know, the kind of legacy that we have that comes from the 19th century. I'm not sure, there's no reason for that, right, other than students of Agassiz.